How you doing? Thanks for tuning in. I'm Jimmy. We're making it work. We're going to spend a day in the shop fixing some cars. I'm trying to change my intro up a little bit. I've had a few people tell me that they're not sure what's going to happen in my video. So I'm thinking a lot of people might click on it but not watch because they don't know what the video is going to be about. So let me know what you think about that. I'm going to put little clips from each car, just a few tenths of a second or a second. If I work on six cars that day, it'll be six little clips of the cars I'm doing. Steering U-joint. This fuse right here, not in bad shape considering the mileage and the age. And then you'll see my ugly mug doing the intro after that. I kind of think it'll be cool. It's something I like, but I want to know what you guys think. Let me know. Oh, I know what you want to see. I did the painting my door panels yesterday. I painted the doors, getting them ready to go back on the truck. I'm not going to install them until after the glasses, windshields, and they're working on that tomorrow, supposedly. I hope this one goes smoothly. It'll be the fourth windshield. But anyway, we're not here for the project truck. You guys know the deal. That's my personal thing, and that's on Sundays. It's totally separate. We're doing a day in the shop. I got the condenser to finish on the Ford Escape. Some people call them escapes, whatever. And we're going to do that. And Joe's coming back from vacation today. We got a ton of cars in the parking lot. So let's get in there, have some fun, and learn a thing or two, and enjoy the new intro. Stay tuned. I'm going to start the day doing the steering U-joint. I'm not sure what they're talking about, this play in it or something, but we got a new U-joint. Let's put it in. Should be right up there somewhere. There it is. Looks like just two bolts. Should be able to get a mountain wrench in there. Is it a 13? Oh my goodness gracious, it looks just like a 12. It's an imposter. All right, now we got a 13. That didn't take nearly as long for you as it did for me to switch that out. Yeah. The U-joint does actually look like it's showing a lot of wear. So, we got it fixed up. I believe this should be a slip joint, like an intermediate shaft style slip joint. If you haven't seen those, they're splined. So if you get in a crash, the column can collapse, or the intermediate shaft can collapse. So I should be able to push it up towards the car to get it off the rack and pinion. And I gotta get this top bolt as well. Show you the top bolt. So you see what I'm doing, that top bolt up there, same deal. We'll play with this a little while. Now, we moved on to pickle juicer status, and comes right out of there. One more of those. I almost forgot I have a 3/8 high speed ratchet. Some of you guys might have remembered the video and been saying, why doesn't Jimmy just use that one? Now, before I de-spline or decouple anything, I'm gonna make sure I'm gonna have everything back where it belongs. I think I'll let it down and lock the steering wheel by turning the key back off, because I had it slightly unlocked so I could roll it around. But now I want it to stay in place so I can lift everything apart and put it back together and not have the steering wheel off center. I think the best course of action will be to straighten the wheel and the tire, of course. Get it nice and straight. Now I'll lock the steering, replace the part, then go ahead and unlock the steering to put it back together. So I only roll it to get to the bolts, right? But I don't want to roll it while it's apart. That would be bad. Now that might be a flat. I thought it was going to be all spline like an import. I guess not. Just because these are, I think these are made in like Brazil or something. I don't know. I thought they were going to be splined. If it's flatted like that, that's nice. Should come off the steering shaft almost exactly the same way. Oh, you won't be able to see it, will you? Steering shaft's pulling out with it. Let me come up with a plan.
2018 Genesis.
50,707 miles. AC's off. He wants to know why the AC doesn't work. Pep Boys told him he has a bad thermostat keeping the AC from working. Very possible. If it doesn't like the thermostat and the way it's working, it will take away your AC to make you fix it, because it's an emission item. Technology's awesome.
Love rating,
I'm gonna say 6. other than a jacket and some stuff. It's in pretty nice shape, pretty clean. It's only got 50,000 miles on it. It's 4 or 5 years old, right? Hyundai. My son loves these cars. He said it's not a Hyundai. Just came up as a Hyundai on my scan tool. But, you know, you young folks can't learn anything. Just like us old dogs, we can't learn new tricks. Same thing. It's a people thing more than your age, really. 16-pin DLC automatically search. We're going to go in. I'm going to clear the thermostat code, see if the air starts working. What do you think about that? Oh, no. There's, like, lots of options. I'm going to go with USA area. And, we don't want that. System list, use some gums. Go ahead and scan all the modules in case there's codes and other modules having an impact on it. One code, I'm guessing a PO128 thermostat rationality code. We'll try clearing that code, see if the air works. And if it does, then we know he's going to need a thermostat. Pretty accurate when you get those codes that the thermostat's sticking open slightly or not opening all the way or something along those lines. The way to test for it is to compare the ambient air temperature and the coolant temperature sensor when the engine's cold. They should be within a few degrees of each other. And then as the engine warms up, you should see the coolant sensor rise and the ambient air should stay the same or close to it. They should not agree as the engine warms up, right? But if the engine's been running for 10 or 15 minutes and it's still kind of cold, it means the thermostat's stuck open, it's flowing too much coolant and it can't warm up fast enough, and it sets that code. It's actually a very common problem. If it's not a coolant sensor or connector type issue, it's the thermostat. So we're gonna let this finish up, verify the codes, send a report, then we'll clear them and see if the AC works. Report, we only have those two codes. Thermostat heater control circuit low, that's interesting. PO59800, that's a new one. B111216 ignition voltage low. This is very strange. Thermostat heater, so it must use, have a, sometimes they'll have multiple thermostats and sometimes they have electric thermostats. And it heats up, helps get the coolant warm, get the engine warmed up quicker to lower emissions a tiny little bit. So what we're gonna do is go in the ECM and see if it says AC denied, or it'll say permission, denied or granted, or yes or no, something like that. We'll take a look at that. Whew, it's getting warm in here. It's like 87 degrees already this morning in the humid, but we're gonna get this AC working here in a second, I have a feeling, temporarily though. AC compressor on by ECU, AC on condition, AC request. I think that should give us enough information. We can look at the ambient air temperature and some of those things too, but first we'll do this. Focus, focus. Oh, there's Rob. AC compressor on by ECU off. AC on condition, AC request on. So it's saying nope, can't have it. Now we're going to find out if it's a hard fault or not. We're going to clear fault code and see what happens. Ignition on, engine off. Oh, it's such a pleasant song. Clear fault code completed. Let me read fault code. No trouble code. Back. Now we'll start it up, see what happens with the AC. It may just reset the code real quick. Depends on if there's a short or something really bad going on with the electrical components in that thermostat. Not getting cold yet. We'll go back in the ECM. We'll look at the same data parameters and see what we see with that. This takes a second. Yeah, I brought up the same data parameters. It said AC compressor off, so I went in to search for codes again and reset the code pending. So it's not going to let you have AC until you fix this issue. So let's look up a PO598. That's a new one. This is a fairly new car. I usually work on, you know, 88 Cadillacs and stuff, so I got to figure this one out. So we'll go see what that code leads us towards. We'll pop that hood and get up in there. I'm sure this one has plastic panels all over it. I try to make it like a European car. So it takes like 40 minutes to get to the engine. Sometimes, we'll see. All right, let's go over this real quick. Fuse right here is the potential cause for this code, but if you look at the way this fuse is wired, it also comes over here and powers up the control for the fuel pump relay. Now the ECM grounds it, but it sends ignition power to the fuel pump relay and ignition power to the thermostat on this wire, which goes off the page to another diagram. There's a whole bunch. And then the ECM controls the ground. I'll show you that one. The ECM controls the ground on this yellow wire, and that fuse powers the positive power side of the thermostat. So, not much point in going any further. If the fuse is blown, it wouldn't run. It's got a bad thermostat. unless the ECM is not controlling it or the control wire or power wire are broken down at the thermostat. Problem is you can't get to it. It's about 4 hours of labor. So we're going to get a thermostat for it if they want to fix it. And then we'll check the connector and the pins and all that stuff while we're in there. And we'll have the part, because most likely that's going to be what it needs. And since it's so new, there's no information. That's all you get. Labor and diagram, a wiring diagram. No repair, no bulletins, no nothing about it. It makes me a little sad. We'll figure it out. We'll see where we go with this one.
All right, while we work on that.
You're keyed on both sides. See, I don't have to be so worried about it being off-center. That U-joint does look like it's in a world of hurt. I keep it in my hand until I figure out which way it goes. It might not matter. Is one side longer than the other? I don't think so. Hey, look. That's not the original one. It's been changed once before. I'm going to say it goes in like that. What do you think? That's pretty funny. That's a Dorman part. All right, enough horsing around. That's what we're dealing with.
Someone said you don't give us enough close-ups.
Oh yeah?
I'll give you a close-up. I'll give you a close-up and you're struggling. Oh, there it is. It goes this way. You can see where the pinch bolt is. Get on there, will you? Oh, ow, I lost my light. You guys are in the dark now. I apologize.
Takes a lick and it keeps on ticking. I'm glad these aren't splined, but all you gotta do now is worry about where the notch is for the bolt, because the bolt passes through and kind of holds it in place. Even if the bolt loosens, as long as it doesn't fall out, it's not going anywhere. Condensers here. This is also, looks like a Dorma steering shaft. Just like the original one was Dorman. I mean, the replacement one. Originally the bolt wasn't tight, but the U-joint was also loose. Now I gotta tighten these two bolts here. It's gonna be like a brand new car. Uh-oh. Oh, come on, Milwaukee. Killing me.
Well, I think I found out why this was loose.
You can't get the bolt in and pinch the shaft, because it's 180 degrees out, and I haven't let anything turn. Keep that in mind. We're doing this because the steering was sloppy and it had a lot of play in it. When I look at this, it matches the threads and the threads. So it's the same joint. This is aftermarket, keep in mind. And when I went to tighten the top bolt, it wasn't grabbing the shaft. And I realized it had slipped down. So I pushed them together and I couldn't get the bolt in. And now I'm looking at it, and if you see the little notch is on the driver's side of that shaft and the top of this one, but you can't put it in that way because the bolt will go through on the driver's side there, but it's on the bottom of the rack. So one of them's out 180. This wasn't bolted in on both sides. This thing was driving down the road for who knows how long, only bolted in on one side. That's pretty damn scary. That's why it had play in the steering. Now I got to figure out which way I want to go. Because if I go 180 the wrong way, it may damage the clock spring. I don't know. Very strange, but I'm going to have to turn something 180 to get this bolted on. And it's the same from side to side, too. If you roll it around, it doesn't matter. I know I'm going to get that in the comments. But so, I'm going to turn the rack 180, and we'll see what happens. All right. After some horsing around, I got it. Come on, Milwaukee. It's kind of tight. I'm about to hit it with the old ratchet wrench. Alright. Finally. Now the steering will be tight. The bolt actually caught both shafts this time. Alright, they said take your pick. Murray or Motorcraft?
Murray or Motorcraft?
Motorcraft. Motorcraft.
That's easy. Oh yeah, look at that son of a gun. That seems like the right one from Ford.
Gotta change these O-rings too, so that's the only problem with the Ford part. It doesn't come with O-rings. Come on, I know you fit off of there. We'll match them up. They don't have to be orange. Green, purple, orange, whatever you like. Even engine O-rings would work, but don't do it the other way around. Don't use AC O-rings on engine oil. Let's see what we got. How does it work?
It's got to be a hair smaller.
I think we'll find something in there.
Got my O-ringy dinghies on there with a little bit of lubrication. I gotta totally remember how this goes. I don't know. You guys remember? Something like that. That's gotta go in the slot that is. That's not so bad.
It's less work than the steering coupler joint.
Gotta grab my 8mm. This is just spacers that's filling in the air gaps.
I hope I don't regret putting this on now, but I feel like it, so I'm gonna. I think the radiator pushes up against the electronics cooler, is what they call it. I think that pushes up against this, that's why I'm putting it on now. It's really easy to take back off if I have to.
All right, let's move down. The tabs on the bottom, you gotta get those little legs in at the bottom. It's got nice legs too, trust me. Now, hoses. Sometimes it takes a little bit of twisting and wiggling. I didn't get much out of there, so I'm using the pre-diluted stuff. Yeah. That's not so bad. Put a couple of bolts in the top here so it doesn't fall. I can lift it up and something snagging underneath. I think that little splash thing snagging it. We'll get it sorted out. Those are exactly fit as easily as you think it might, but it has been tweaked in an accident, so. Just got to make a couple of little adjustments. Perfect. All right, I'm gonna let this thing finish vacuuming down. 38 ounces of Freon. Takes conventional PAG 46. I'm gonna put about an ounce and a half in there for the new condenser. And we'll see how the AC works. It worked before, but it was leaking, so should be good. Let's see what the oil looks like while we're waiting. Peachy keen. Add oil now.
All right, ounce and a half coming your way, baby. Use this little chart on the side here, get an idea where you're at. I'm gonna go a little bit below this line. All right, time to make sweet music. I wonder if we're supposed to do the actuator. I haven't checked, I gotta see. I'll give this thing a minute to run. Feels like it's cooling off already. I don't know how it worked before, honestly. I'm not the one that sold the condenser, but it was definitely leaking. So hopefully we're good to go. And we'll let this thing run a little bit, maybe take it for a little drive. Pressures are doing something up there, if you can see it. It's not pulling the low side down too good, though. All right, we'll let it run a few minutes and see what the pressures do. All right, pressures are pretty decent. It's cold inside. I even put a new cap on the low side instead of putting the tape back on it. I'll take the sink for a drive, make sure everything's good on the road, and see what's next. Let's go ahead and get the door panel off of this one from last week, see what that regulator looks like. One are there, two there, a bunch of Phillips screwers. Then it should just be clips around the outer edge of the door, I believe. Anyway, you find a clipper doodle. Problem is,
It's the door strength versus the clip strength. And one of them is going to give, just a matter of which one is going to give first. I try to get as close to the clip as I can so I don't crack the door panel too bad. But sometimes they break anyway. Not much you can do about it. Except give it your best effort.
That just pops out of there. That's easy.
Yeah. There you go. So hard about that. Some of the clips stay in, some of the clips don't. Now you got to get all these clips out of the door, put them in the panel, because you won't be able to slip the panel back on all of them correctly. You got to transfer them all over. This blue point junk's just not going to cut it. So we're going to upgrade molar caps. Got it from the gear wrench guy. Haven't used them yet. I was going to make a tool video about them. I haven't had time. Between working on the truck and working on the yard and editing and so I'm gonna put them in my day in the shop videos when I get tools. I got these on the gear wrench truck. They're like 130 bucks. They're really proud of them. But on a Snap-on truck would have been like 480. But I'm totally guessing. I don't know what it is. They're like jewelry. So they're all different sizes and shapes and different angles. This one's for smaller clips than this one. And I don't know. I'm hoping one of these works for this. Let's try this one. We'll see what happens. Oh yeah. Now when you get some stubborn ones, you can't quite get good leverage. You can try this. Oh, throwing your jewelry on the ground. That's worth $8 less now. I'm gonna try this, see how it works. I don't know. The problem is the opening's too big for this clip. This small opening actually works pretty well. Not the best, but it worked. Let's put this window down and see where we're at. This thing was all cattywampus for some reason or another. It's not connected. That's why. We'll sort that out. Oh, it just broke all the plastic rollers and stuff that connect the glass to the regulator broke. So we'll see what we got in the box, and we'll have to replace that. Hopefully it comes with those parts. If it doesn't, we'll be putting it back together and ordering those parts. Stay tuned. Two of those. Here's the broken pieces. If I can get them out of there. All that trouble because the roller split in half. I just popped this forward out of the slot and I should be able to get the glass out. I'm gonna get my little bag thing and my little inflatable deal, and I'll hold the glass up out of our way while we do this regulator. I'm hoping it comes with all of that stuff, which I think it does. It's a scissor style regulator, not cable. Now, very carefully, we're gonna take these tens very carefully. I'm gonna probably have to collapse it to fit it out of the hole here. So I'm gonna leave it plugged in until I figure out what it's gonna take to fit it out of there. Looking at it, I think it goes in here kind of like this. And this guide here is like that. So get yourself a good idea what you're dealing with before you unbolt all the goodies. And it looks like the right one, so we'll be in good shape. So unbolt this first. And since it's a one-piece unit, it's not like the older cars. The older cars, there's separate tracks and stuff, and if you unbolt them, the thing goes whooshink, and the big spring on it will force it to hurt you. So you gotta be careful. The older ones, you pull the motor out of it, and then it's no longer holding the springs back. And people would lose fingers. So you gotta be careful. This style, the motor stays attached. You have to put the motor in with the regulator. So we're killing a bunch of birds, a bunch of stones, or something like that. I forget how it goes. Now that bolt and that bolt, you can leave in to help you lay it in place. But let me get some rags so I can do this without catching sharp edges on the fingers. Rubber gloves probably won't help you in this situation. They're so thin, they'll just, you know, you're gonna get cut, it'll cut right through it. I don't have to power it because of this secondary track. That'll let me scissor the lift. Kind of like I've been out drinking with a good friend too much. So, I'm sorry, this is... not so bad. All of that because of that little tiny plastic ball. Now this one, reverse. See, once this is locked in place, I wouldn't be able to manually operate it. Find the bolts. Lock them in. Now I'll have to power it to get it where I want it after I bolt this in. This also has a direction. You can see the little tab that goes in this hole. Aha, it was catching up on this door pull rod. I can do it without running the motor. I just had to put it over this rod. It goes in between. It goes in between the track. So, all right. A few bolts. This thing should be underway. I'm going to lower it once I bolt this, and I'll lower it so I can get the glass back on it. Get that pretty close. Now I just got to get my glass down there. Get the glass down there and get them studs back in. The tracks will help guide it a little bit. Now, once you get it lined up, then you got to slide it forward onto the studs. Hope that shows up on camera there. Use a screwdriver or something probably here so it's not sharp on the thingies. Come on, glass. Do it. There it is. Ah, that's what we want. Uh-oh. I'm leaking. Worked every time before, we were only fixing a noise. There's something going on with this plug. Oh my goodness! That's not desirable. I think the new regulator, I think the female pins are too large. A little wore out beat up from the feet up. Not even working the switch. All right, got a connection issue in here. Let me go ask them up front what they want to do. Might have to put another regulator in it. All right, we'll try that, see if that helps. Man, it's hard to get parts nowadays. It's just such a pain. Everything's junk that you get. Shouldn't say everything. Only 90%, not everything. I shouldn't exaggerate like that. Turn the key back on. I'll try it some more. All right, modifying the pins worked. I'm gonna still let them know what I had to do to get it to work and see if they wanna leave it, let it fly. It'll be under warranty for 3 years, 36,000 miles, which means we can do it again right now or wait and see how it works now that I bent the pins tight. Because cheap parts, even expensive parts, I've seen defects, just not as often. Stick that water shield back up there. I don't want any internet warriors complaining. I want everybody happy. which I guess that's basically impossible, but I'm still going to try. I'm just going to put the door panel back on there. You guys saw how it came off, right? Put the door panel on. We'll work the window a few more times. We're going to make a note on the ticket about me modifying that connection. And if we have any more issues, of course, the customer's covered for 3 years, 36,000 miles. Easy peasy and lemon juice. Got to get your lock knob in there. Got a basically hobnob with your lock knob. Problem is, the push pins want to fight you. I guess you're going to have to put the lip of the door panel over onto the rubber after you get the push pins in place. There you go. There's push pins all along the top here. I can't help. I can't explain it. It's like brand new. That's one way to handle your maintenance required light. If you can't see it, it's not on. But the window works and it's quiet. Nice. Like a brand new truck. Let's go see what's next. 2006 Mercury Mariner Hybrid, 178,800 miles, 799 to be exact. It's gonna get a love rating of 5. It's old, it's been down the river a time or two, and not in bad shape considering the mileage and the age. It's a regular customer of ours, but she had a bunch of work done somewhere else. Struts and brakes and all kinds of stuff. It won't start and it has no brake pedal. So we're gonna find out why. 2006 Mercury Mariner Hybrid, 178,800 miles. 799 to be exact. It's gonna get a love rating of 5. It's old, it's been down the river a time or two, and not in bad shape considering the mileage and the age. It's a regular customer of ours, but she had a bunch of work done somewhere else. Struts and brakes and all kinds of stuff. It won't start and it has no brake pedal. So we're gonna find out why. Man, another shop or a mobile mechanic or someone, I'm not sure who, but rotors, pads, struts, sway bar links, lower control arms, same thing on the other side. Rear pads, but no rotors or anything. I cracked all the bleeders to see if there was air and I didn't see anything. I'm gonna clamp off all the hoses and see if I get a pedal. We'll clamp off the hose and the caliper on all four wheels. Should have a rock hard pedal at that point. It's remotely possible something going on in the ABS, but that's normally not the case. It could be stuck in some kind of bypass mode, so we may have to prove that out too, or run an ABS bleed test, that kind of thing, see if we can change the pedal at all. Let's go ahead and clamp these off. I'm gonna use my little Mac hose clamp dealios. Gotta unscrew them first. There you go, that's better. And these don't hurt the hose. Some people worry that they're gonna hurt the hose, but the only way it hurts the hose is if the hose is dry rotted and ready to fail anyway. It will not hurt a good hose. You're clamping off rubber and then letting it relax again. I wouldn't use anything sharp. I see some people use vice grips and stuff. I wouldn't use those unless you have the ones that have the flat bill that's made to clamp them off without doing damage. If it has teeth, then the teeth could harm the rubber. That's a different story, but. All right, hoses are clamped off. There is no brake pedal. So either someone was bleeding it and the master cylinder piston bore stuck forward. That happens on vehicles that sit a lot, and this vehicle sits a lot, and that's annoying. So it's possible that the master cylinder bore is stuck forward. That's what it feels like. I mean, there's nothing there. It's almost like the master cylinder is unbolted. Let me take a look at that and make sure it's all bolted in, bolts didn't fall out or something. When someone else does that much work, you have no idea what you're getting into, and you just got to basically eliminate every possibility. I'll look at that really quick and check the fluid level. Something very strange going on. You could, worst case scenario, you can unbolt the lines from the master and put metal plugs with the same thread pitch in the master, see if the pedal gets hard. Obviously, if still doesn't, then you're 110% sure if that's possibly more than 100%. I hate when people say that. I put 110% effort in. You put more than the maximum possible amount of effort. Got the scan tool on this thing. Apparently, the ABS units go bad way more than the master cylinders. And even more common is a bleeding procedure that is really cool. You have to use a pressure bleeder on the master cylinder, have a gallon and a half of brake fluid, and have a container at each wheel with a hose coming from the bleeder into the container that has brake fluid in it, and the hose is submerged in the brake fluid. Then you go into the ABS module. I went in and had a look at the codes and stuff too. I sent a report up front with all the codes listed so I can try clearing them out. And I'm gonna try a bleed procedure real quick. I know it works on a lot of GM trucks and stuff. If you do a bleed procedure without even opening any bleeders, then the ABS module will purge air from itself and it tends to back up into the reservoir in the master. Or you'll find it travels a little bit, so at least you can get it out of the ABS and have it come out of one of the wheels by manually bleeding them. This thing is going to be a little bit unusual. So we have got tons of codes, including pump volume feed codes, obviously voltage codes, the battery's at 11.5 volts, brake fluid level codes, even though it's not low, error from external node, all kinds of sensor pressure codes, sensor codes, calibration not complete, blah, blah, blah. There is a bunch of pages and pages of codes. So I sent the report in case we need to refer to any of those. And I'm going to try clearing the codes first. And we'll go from there. We'll clear all the DTCs, see what comes back. And we'll try a bleeding procedure. See if we can get some kind of a brake pedal doing that. If we have to, we'll have to try, like I said, capping off the master cylinder. Because people are also finding that the master cylinder, when they get worn and they don't push a lot of fluid volume, you can't even complete the bleeding procedure properly. So they end up doing both. Guys are talking about it taking an hour, hour and a half, and a gallon and a half of brake fluid to bleed them. So, but first, I'm going to just try a regular bleeding procedure, and we'll see if that makes any improvement on the pedal. Right now, it just goes right to the floor. So let's do that, and we'll come back. All right, when you go in the ABS module and special functions, this is what it does for you. Replace brake pads, check brake system air bleeding, service bleeding includes brake fluid replacement without power bleeder, and check brake system actuation control unit. So I'm gonna do this one first to see what happens. I'm gonna run through all these tests. After pressing okay, fully depress the brake pedal slowly, evenly and forcefully for 5 seconds. After reaching the end of pedal travel, hold the pedal for 2 seconds, then release the brake pedal. So I'm going to press OK and then press the brake pedal. Unrecoverable subroutine error. Aborted because pause state of the routine stopped. That's interesting. It has new brake pads. Let's try the replace brake pad. Start in the brake pad replace process. Ensure that the brake pad pedal is not pressed. Press OK to continue. Unrecoverable subroutine error. Okay, check brake system air bleeding. Start the air bleeding check. Depress and release the brake pedal to start the test, then press OK. The lights on the dash are blinking. I'm supposed to be out at the wheels probably opening bleeders and manually bleeding it, I suppose, but unrecoverable subroutine error again. All right, this is not a good sign. Brake fluid replacement without power bleeder. Start the brake fluid replacement. Ensure the brake pedal is not pressed. Press OK. Unrecoverable subroutine error. Now, I have to figure out if that's the scan tool or something going on with the car. Interesting. Service bleeding setup instructions. Remove cap, blah, blah, blah. Ensure. Turn on the power bleeder until prompted. This is why they want you to pressurize the system and bleed the brakes. And if it has a bad master cylinder, that's not going to work. It may prove to be a waste of time. So very interesting. Why this is set up this way, no idea. There's some kind of a reason. There's hoses going from the master cylinder over to the ABS unit. So they're interconnected. So basically, I'm probably going to need to cap off the master cylinder and see if I can get the master cylinder and the pedal to be hard. And if I do, then it's something going on with the ABS. But it's going to be a little more involved, so we'll see what's going to happen with this one. It's got all new parts somebody else put on it. And I don't know if this was because it had no brake pedal or if it has no brake pedal after doing all the work. So I need a little more information. and possibly more time to try to test this out and determine if it's the ABS unit or the master cylinder. Could even be both. So let's do that, and we'll figure things out with that, and we'll come back. Real quick before I go up front, I just realized, you know, let me take a look at some data just to see if there's any action coming from the master cylinder, because this car has all this hybrid technology and the brake system's unusual. There's going to be a lot more data than your average car. So I brought up some of that data. It says brake bleed check done, brake on off. When I push the brake, that goes to on. Brake pedal travel sensor calibration status not completed. That's interesting. Brake pressure applied. If I push on the brakes, it starts to show me some brake pressure, but I don't feel much of anything happening in the pedal. But it's doing something. There's a whole bunch of data PIDs for the same function. It's kind of strange that it does that, but who am I to judge? Brake pressure transducer accumulator. That should have more pressure than that. The way this works is, I think it works like a hydro boost kind of system, which is the electric boosted master cylinder. But the ABS is somehow involved. There's a motor on the ABS, unusual compared to what most ABSs have for motors. So I'm kind of sorting through this all like a rooster in a hen house kind of thing. Now I'm going to go up front and see what they want to do. I do have some activity from the master cylinder. That's what I wanted to see. That I'm getting back 150 PSI. So the master cylinder is trying to do something. Even if it's bad, it's doing something. And I know the sensors are reading the pressure, and they seem about accurate compared to how the pedal feels. So now I'm going to go see how far they want to go. I think this brake check is 0.3. And I got to look for an oil leak or something from the transaxle too. I don't know. This is like a $1,200 vehicle, so I'm not really... We'll see what happens with this one. Back to where we were about 5 minutes ago. All right, they do also want to see if we can get it to crank up. So I pushed a little reset button. Not sure if you can see that, but that takes some voltage from the 12-volt battery while it's charging and puts a surface charge on the hybrid battery to let it start the engine so it can recharge itself. It kind of fools the hybrid module. So we're going to try that, see if it'll crank up. It's got to sit about 8 minutes. Then that light will start blinking. You should be able to start it. You got a 2-minute window to catch it. So I'm going to set myself a little oven timer, and we'll hover around the vehicle. And then we'll try to start it up. And if it starts and runs, at least we know that works. This vehicle sits a lot, and I've done it before with this vehicle. Eventually, it hurts the hybrid battery because you constantly let it sit discharged. It's not a good idea. And we've told them that over and over, but for about 6 years on and off, they bring it in with a dead battery, and we have to do this over and over. Except this time, they added that brake issue, which we're still sorting that out too. Stay tuned. All right, they want to try a bleed, but we're going to do the conventional way because I don't have a pressure bleeder. I'm going to try the conventional way first. If it doesn't work, then we'll try Joe's pressure bleeder. Let's see what happens. Shouldn't be too big of a dealio. I got a little bit of a pedal just by going around bleeding it by myself, so I'm kind of optimistic. Maybe I shouldn't be. We'll see. Eyes and ears, people. I'll give it a try, see how it goes. All four wheels. Second wheel. We got a, the Cadillac I did the intake and valve cover gaskets on here. I don't know why it's even here yet. And the 55 Chevy's got a bad lock cylinder. The key is stuck in the lock cylinder, so I got to order parts for that. Can you see it out there? It's a little tiny car from here. All right, let's see what this brake pedal feels like. I went around all four wheels. It acted kind of weird. When I pulled the vacuum tool off, I couldn't get it to gravity bleed any fluid out. So that's a bad sign. But we're going to try the pedal. We'll see. Well, the brake lights are still on, but it's weird. The pedal feels different. Like there's something happening at the top, at least now. So don't ever say optimism doesn't pay off. I mean, even if it didn't pay off this time, that's no reason to not be optimistic. Sure. All right. That's we're closing up and ending this video right here. I appreciate you guys watching. Hope you enjoyed today's video. I hope you'll torque the like button on the way out, and I hope I'll see you in the next video, because you're awesome.